ना मनोज सामने है तो मैं बाकी मेरे बारे में कुछ बोलने की जरूरत नहीं. एनीवे थैंक यू वेरी मच. गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबॉडी. एंड इट्स लाइक यू नो वॉकिंग डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम एयरपोर्ट टू हियर. एंड थैंक यू जयंतो, थैंक यू श्रीनी, ऑफकोर्स डॉक्टर मुरुगनाथन, अनुज, अमर सिंह, वेर आर यू, ओके एवरीबॉडी, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर दिस ब्यूटिफुल अपॉर्चुनिटी. नाउ बिफोर आई डू दैट आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट ऑल ऑफ यू प्लीज स्टैंड अप अ बिट. Let us pay our respect to the fellow who we lost, unfortunately. Pride of India we lost. In memory of our CDS General, Bipin Rawat, and entire 13 people, those who have lost their life. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. So friends, I'm going to talk to you about COVID-induced coagulopathy. A story which starts here in Agam will really talk about, because Agam recently has published along with Dr. Chopra and team a beautiful paper in JAPI. In this JAPI, Agam published a paper on COVID-induced or COVID-associated coagulopathy, a story which starts actually as a story of inflammation. And we all know that this blizzard of inflammation really triggers and is responsible for most of the challenges that people of COVID will have. But one such outcome of COVID is an immune outrage, which actually impacts the immediate and the long-term morbidity as well as mortality, is what is called as a COVID-associated coagulopathy or COVID-induced coagulopathy. So let's discuss this in next 15 minutes or so. I am Dr. Mangesh Divaskar. There are some important disclosures that I have, that we all are aware that the knowledge of COVID is still evolving and we are still learning. Every day we spend during this COVID times, we are getting some new information. Believe me, there are more than 52 studies which are already published on the COVID and associated coagulopathies. So my discussions are going to be entirely upon the guidelines which are published by various organizations, including the Thrombosis Society of America. And along with that, the scientific peer-reviewed literature. And I'll just give you the bird's eye view. I'm not going to talk to you in details about the management strategies, the different drugs, the mechanism of actions of the drugs. But there are a few new terminologies that you'll surely know. Few of them, those who have worked in COVID, are aware about these terminologies. But I don't know how many of you are aware that there is a role, what is called as a necrosis. How many of you have heard this term? I'm not sure about it. The presentations of COVID-associated coagulopathy, we are all aware about. Primarily present to you with the venous thromboembolic phenomena. It can happen in pulmonary circulation. It can happen in general venous circulation. It can present as microangiopathies. And that was a feature of most of the postmortem lungs that people have explored. And of course, there are a few other macroangiopathies like myocardial infarctions, increasing the risk of strokes, DVT, probably sometimes the peripheral vascular disease acceleration was also noted. And the incidence anywhere ranges between 15 to 53%. In fact, one of the latest French studies have actually showed that the incidence of COVID-associated coagulopathy was to a tune of around 90%. Now that was what. And thanks to Agam again being, you know, one of the co-faculties for this paper, which was published in JAC. This was presented as a paper in the American Heart Association International Congress during the ACC 2021, but also has got a place in JAC in May 11th edition of this. And we talked about thromboprophylaxis in improving the outcomes in COVID-19. So the story dawns here in alveoli, and it starts by COVID virus attacking the type 2 nematocytes. But apart from the inflammatory response, there are some COVID or a coagulable COVID associated coagulation challenges. And the challenges are usually very high levels of soluble thrombin levels, very high levels of von Willebrand factor that actually leads to formation of microthrombi, and ultimately along with necrosis, basically because of the excessive recruitment of neutrophils at the site, will cause a coagulopathy. So let's have an overview of a coagulopathy. We all are aware that hemostasis has three different components. You know, no matter it could be an extrinsic injury or an intrinsic injury. Extrinsic, external injury, it's a very quick response of the body. And that is the reason why it's a very short pathway. But whenever you talk about intrinsic, that means body wants to stop coagulation as a response to a small intrinsic triggers. So it requires a long clearance pathways. And that is the reason why intrinsic pathways are always long time taking pathways. Extrinsic response is extremely quick, where there is initial immediate vasoconstriction along with the platelet plug formation, and then a vasculation or the coagulation cascade kicks off. And then naturally, once the entire, thrombus is formed, then if at all there is an intravascular coagulation happening, then the anti-thrombus mechanisms are kicked off. So coagulation cascade, which is classically also initiated by what we call it as proenzymes, or also called as zymogens, are actually the glycoproteins which are present, which are responsible for the sequence of the events to give you ultimately a clot formation, and then you do have a natural fibrinolysis. Now, these are different clotting factors, and these are the two different mechanisms. I'm not going into the details about it, but you can see clearly that extrinsic mechanism or the extrinsic clot formation trigger is extremely fast and very, very sharp, whereas intrinsic mechanism takes a long time. I could not stop myself in telling you about the mnemonic, how I remembered these clotting factors. And this term, you know, this sentence has made my life really easy. Few people try climbing long slopes after Christmas. Some people have fallen. Now, this was the simple mnemonic that I remembered when I remembered the mnemonic. Don't worry about it. So it's a sort of a, I would say, association of different factors which actually causes that Virchow's triad challenge, where you have got a hypercoagulable state, where, of course, we do have got a hypercoagulable state where there is an excessive thrombin burst, and that is, that can be easily formed on what we call it as the thrombus elastography. And then, of course, there is a short K that tells you about the thrombin generation. And also there is a clot strength, which is very, very strong. And this is primarily because of one area, it is netosis. Now, I'm repeating this term netosis again and again, because once you understand what this netosis is, you'll realize that why these clots, which are usually formed because of the COVID-associated coagulopathy, are so resistant for fibrinolytic therapy, where that is the place where your fibrinolysis or the lytic therapies, they don't work. So the best way to do and to try and avoid this is usually a good anticoagulation. And along with this, there is an endothelial injury. And of course, stasis, because of the long-term immobilization, is going to add to it. Now, you would be wondering, what is the picture and what this exactly is? What is this picture? This is the longest, the largest endocrine organ of the body. Surface area is very, very high, and the tissue immediately below this I am talking about endothelium. So a normal endothelium has got an absolute phenomenal ability to stop getting natural coagulation in the flowing blood. And especially this endothelial matrix that I am talking about has got natural heparin inhibiting factors. There are nitrous oxide stopping factors. There are prostaglandins. There are thrombomodulins modulators which are there, but which will stop the blood coagulating inside. But what happens in COVID? The immunopathogenesis, the systemic inflammation, apart from that, the cytokine bursts, all this will cause endothelial dysfunction. And one of the prominent mechanisms of endothelial dysfunction is excessive RAS. Now, why you get an excessive RAS activity? It's a direct effect of SARS-CoV virus on the angiotensin 1. But more interestingly, as we all are aware, that these spike proteins of SARS, they bind to ACE2 receptors. Now, ACE2 receptors are phenomenal. Remember them. ACE2 receptors are mandatory to stop the progression of the inhibited progression of the angiotensin mechanism. Remember that ACE2 degrades angiotensin 2. We all know angiotensin is usually stimulated whenever there is a hypotension. The renal perfusion goes down, the peripheral perfusion is poor, and there is an excessive angiotensin mechanisms trigger. These are all natural triggering mechanisms. But this angiotensin, which has got a tremendous vasoconstrictive properties, needs to be stopped. It cannot continue. Otherwise, the patient can have a real genuine challenge of perfusion. So this angiotensinogen 2 is neutralized with the help of ACE. Now, it are these ACE2, which are usually taken up by the SARS-CoV And that is the reason why there is an uninhibited action of angiotensin. So there is an extravagant stimulation of angiotensinogen 2, which will ultimately cause peripheral vasoconstriction, stasis, stagnation. Along with that, it will cause increase in the local reactive oxygen species release, will trigger the, cytokines. And not only that, it will reduce the natural vasodilatation happening because of the nitrous oxide. And along with the cytokine challenges, it will cause a severe endothelial dysfunction, which leads to this challenge. So on one side, you have got a beautiful endothelium, which has got all the protective properties. But the moment the trigger of SARS-CoV happens, this endothelium starts becoming porous, and which is anti-inflammatory becomes pro-inflammatory, which has got an anticoagulant property, starts becoming hypercoagulable. And then you get excessive recruitment of lymphocytes and neutrophils along with the cytokine challenges to add to the complement story to the whole system. And that will worsen the challenge. Why? Because the complements coming into the scenario will cause excessive recruitment of polymorphonucleocytes, and which will lead to what is called as netosis. So I'll spend a couple of minutes on what are these nets, neutrophil extracellular taps. Beautiful mechanism. I was not aware before I really prepared for this talk that neutrophils, they have got such a tremendous potential. And what does they do? Actually, in response to the insult, we all know that polymorphonucleocytes, which are the part of the innate immunity, we are born with it, right? And they respond. They respond by recognizing what we call it as DAMs and PAMs, damage-associated molecular proteins, or the pathogen-associated molecular proteins. They'll sense it. And what happens is that not only they degranulate, but the chromatin, the nucleus chromatin, is thrown as a fisherman's net. Now, we are in Goa, so who better than fisher people here will realize the importance of fisherman net. So there is an excessive early recruited neutrophils showing an aggressive net formation. And these nets have got the toxic compounds like histones or myeloperoxidase or proteinase 3, which has got a tremendous capacity to stimulate the cytokine response. And they disrupt not only the alveolar epithelium, but also vascular endothelium. Actually, they do have got a capacity to trap the microorganisms. And that is the reason why these are the webs of the DNA, which consists histones, microbiocidal proteins, and oxidant enzymes that are released in response to the pathogens. Now, that is our defense mechanism. Now, this is a beautiful video that you can see where these excessive neutrophils are getting recruited. And you can see in yellow and green, so much of nets are thrown. Now, this is an electron microscopic film of the neutrophil elastase release and the chromatin release. And you can clearly see the amount of the chromatin material getting degenerated. And look at the beautiful colorized scan picture. Now, even though this is not SARS-CoV, but this is in response to Helicobacter, but look at the way these webs of, and what happens is this, that because there is an excessive recruitment of neutrophil, there are so many neutrophils throwing up these webs. So what happens is that there is an aggregation of these nets, and these are called as agnets. And that cause that starts, you know, with the triggering of coagulation cascade. That is the reason why these nets are not responsive to lytic therapies, because there is no blood more involved here. It is more of a chromatin material. So a cascade, a myriad, a crosstalk of immune pathogenesis along with the netosis actually is a basis of COVID-associated coagulopathy. There is also something called as pyroptosis, and which is actually responsible for excessive stimulation of tissue factors, which is also responsible for the excessive coagulation. And then to add to it, naturally, the platelets get activated. And we all know platelets are another beautiful organs. A simple, small, discoid-looking platelet, the moment there is a trigger, changes itself to a completely sticky with multiple phylopodal extensions coming out, and they start becoming sticky, and they'll start, you know, getting stuck to RBCs, to WBCs everywhere. And these platelets, along with the whole coagulation, will lead to immunoinflammatory endotheliitis. So this is, in short, what you generally get in immunoendotheliitis. But remember that one very important thing is this coagulopathy is not a consumptive coagulopathy. We have to remember that. There is no, I would say deficiency or deprivation of the coagulation factors. The coagulation factors are not consumed. So this is not a consumptive coagulopathy. And hence, why it is important to understand? Because what are the lab markers that you will ask for? Primarily, you ask for the inflammatory markers, especially CRPs. We ask for ESR, ferritin levels. And in very rare situations, we ask for PCT levels. Then we ask for the coagulation markers like D-dimer, the commonly asked investigation during the COVID time was D-dimers. And then, of course, in few select cases, we asked for the platelet activation. So look at the whole, tabulation of the various laboratory coagulation parameters that you can ask for. But out of these 7 or 8, there are there on table. The commonly asked are usually D-dimer, sometimes prothrombin time, very rarely fibrinogen, and also simultaneously, sometimes you may ask for a platelet count. Some select situation, you ask for a PTINR. Why? Because PTINR is a direct representation of the extrinsic and the common pathway of the coagulation. And the normal PTINR, you all are aware that it is between 11 to 14 seconds. And in the situation where you want to know about the intrinsic pathway, you'll ask for activated prothrombin time. And that is APTT, which is around 25 to 40. And you know that, you know, it is a little longer time. It is similar to PT. But it is different because it judges the intrinsic factors. And of course, D-dimers, we all are aware about it. They are the fibrin degradation product. They represent the degradation of the fibrin. Now, why D-dimers rise? Because there is an excessive fibrin formation. And as these fibrins are lysed by the natural mechanisms, you get this divalent dimer protein which is released in the blood. And that causes the rise in the D-dimers. Lastly, a beautiful comparison between 4 types of coagulopathies and how do you differentiate between them. And during COVID times, especially in ICU, me and Agam managed, I don't know how many patients together. And we definitely saw these coagulopathies, sepsis-induced coagulopathy, DIC, and the COVID-associated hematological abnormalities or CAHA or COVID-induced coagulopathy. You don't have to ask for all these myriad. Just whenever you want to differentiate between a sepsis-induced coagulopathy and a COVID-associated coagulopathy, only 5 investigations. You don't require anything else. Prothrombin time, rarely activated prothrombin time, D-dimer. Simply to differentiate between the sepsis-induced coagulopathy and a COVID-associated coagulopathy, there is a challenge. Ask for only 1 investigation, D-dimer. I'll be finishing in the next 2 minutes, sir. D-dimers are extremely high, usually in COVID-associated coagulopathies. Yet in sepsis-induced coagulopathy, you will not get D-dimers. Similarly, if you want to differentiate between a DIC and a CAC, what you will do is, again, you'll ask there probably for platelet count, which is the simplest, cheapest, and easily available investigation. It will clearly tell you a difference between a DIC and a COVID-associated coagulopathy. This is an overall bird's eye view of the different typical coagulation profiles of pregnancy. I have included here primarily because there are lot many pregnant patients, those who face this challenge. So a Virchow triad of COVID-associated coagulopathy, where there was on one side virus responsible for the trigger, on the other side you have got the coagulation dysfunction, and on the third side there was a stasis because of the prolonged hospitalization leads to the COVID-associated coagulopathy. Last 2 minutes, I'll be talking about management. Quickly, few pointers. Remember that pharmacological VTE prophylaxis, that is venous thromboembolism prophylaxis, for all the hospitalized non-pregnant patients with confirmed or highly suspected COVID-19, regardless of the VTE risk score. It's very important for you to understand this. But if the patient is pregnant, then it is always advisable to follow some guidance which has been issued by the Obstetrics and Gynecological Society. If there are contraindications for VTE, pharmacological VTE, you may consider the mechanical VTE, especially in the ICU patients. And in the critically ill patients, you may think about, you know, giving them both. There are almost nearly 53, 54 studies which have been already published, prominent are being there on your screen. What they have come out with is that especially in the moderately ill patients, it has been proved that therapeutic anticoagulation is superior. But in the critical patients, those are very sick, on probably gadgets, on ECMOs, on ventilators, you know, probably you don't have, I would say, this choice of therapeutic anticoagulation. Now, lastly, pharmacology, we all know, scoring systems, we all know. These are all the pharmacological agents that we used. Commonly used are enoxaparin. We used also sometimes unfractionated heparin. DOACs, absolutely champions and proved champions. Either they may be direct thrombin inhibitors or they can be a factor 10A inhibitors. So to conclude, key points, SARS-CoV predisposes people for a COVID-associated coagulopathy. There are current guidelines which suggest that all the patients, those who are moderate to severely sick, must be given COVID VTE-related prophylaxis. And most importantly, the duration of the prophylaxis depends on the severity of the illness, the duration of the hospitalization, and the pulmonary involvement. And that's what the BTS guidelines says here. So lastly, to conclude, I'll end up my talk by saying a great teaching by Stephen Hawkins and our late president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, is the greatest reason for failure is not ignorance. It is the illusion of knowledge. But if I have to dare and add one more line to this, now, during COVID era, it is the resistance to change can be the greatest reason for the failure. Vaccination, as Agam loves about it, is the only way to prevent the COVID onslaught that we have. Rest all is history. Thank you very much. And